Thank you, Hollis. Hollis is applying to college. I encourage all of you to ask her where and help her get in. I was trying to pull the schools out of her. I heard Yale and Harvard, so she's an underachiever, and I hope you can all maybe talk some sense into her during the break. I love young people. I'm really glad that there are a lot of people here who are young. And there are a lot of people here who aren't. Those of you who aren't, the way that you communicate with young people, shout it out. You ready? 1, 2, 3. Text! Exactly. In unison. Well done. I ran an organization for a long time called DoSomething.org, which is the largest organization, actually, for young people in America. It's almost 6 million members. That's actually bigger than the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts combined. Maybe because it's not homophobic. Okay. And what Do Something does is it helps young people affect social change, the things that you care about. So they'll do a campaign on hunger, where we'll call all the food pantries and say, everybody collects soup for you. Do you really need soup? And the food pantries will say, no, no more soup. Please, we need protein, non-perishable protein. So that's Spam or peanut butter. We went with peanut butter. And the whole campaign was, are you team crunchy or team smooth? So who is smooth? Yeah, you're right. You're correct. That's right. That's right. And so we'll collect about 200,000 jars of peanut butter in a month. That's a lot of peanut butter. Apologies to anyone with a nut allergy. You've probably been triggered just by hearing the thought of 200,000 jars of peanut butter. But huge campaigns, and that's because the way that Do Something engages young people is the way that you engage young people. It's by text. Sending out a text message every week to millions of young people saying, do you want to participate in this campaign? Text has about a 97% open rate. You open every text you get. No one is really sending you text messages yet about Viagra or text messages about, I lost my wallet in a cab. Please send me $500. I'll send you back $5,000. Some of you remember those emails? Yeah, that has not happened with text. And so you open every text you get. It skews minority, it skews urban, it skews young. It's a phenomenal way to reach young people. But we have this one side effect that we never anticipated. Because you only text really with your parents and your friends, young people really grew to trust us at Do Something and felt close to us. And so we would get a text message back. We'd send out a text message about the PB and Jam Slam, and we would get a couple dozen messages back having nothing to do with peanut butter, nothing to do with hunger or smooth or crunchy, but things like, my boyfriend just hit me, what should I do? Or, I'm being bullied at school, I don't want to go tomorrow. And we were giving them, we were triaging it. Here's a phone number, here's a hotline, talk to your school principal. And then we got a message that was a little bit different. It said exactly this. He won't stop raping me. It's my dad. He told me not to tell anyone. And then the letters, are you there? And one of my employees brought that in and just put that on the desk in front of me and said, I don't know what to do with this one. And we gave her the phone number for RAIN, the Rape and Incest Organization. Oh, we love RAIN. Wait, Scott? What's up? Hi. We love RAIN. And we gave them your number. And the next day, I came in and said, what happened? Have we heard from her? No. I said, give her the number again, because I love you twice. And I will tell you the truth is, we've never heard back from her. I have pulled that phone number myself personally and tried to text her and call her and never heard back from her. And what we realized is that she trusted us. We needed to be there for her the way she needed us, which was by text. So we built Crisis Text Line. Turns out text is a fantastic way to counsel people. We launched in August 2013 here in Chicago, very quietly. We texted 4,000 people in that Do Something database here in Chicago and said, if you or someone you know needs this, it's available by text, which meant you couldn't re-opt in. You had to use the other number. It was like switching red to blue. You had to, not a political way, but like you had to re-opt in a different way. And within 4 months, we were in all 295 area codes in the United States. That's a lot of growth. That's real virality and organic growth. It's very, very sad. Why? Because it turns out text really is a great way to counsel people. You might be texting us right now, and the person sitting next to you would have no idea. During lunch, we spike every day. Kids are texting us from the cafeteria. You think they're texting the cute boy on the other side of the cafeteria. They're actually texting us because they're having a panic attack over the calculus final. We don't get the words like, hyperventilating, crying. We don't get repetition. Text is a terrific way to counsel people, and we get you in that heat of the moment. I thought it was all going to be about bullying. 30% of our messages are about suicide and depression. After that, it's anxiety. And 1 in 5 of our texters indicates self-harm, typically cutting. It's a whole lot of dark, serious, imminent things. We also get a lot of imminent risk texters, people for whom harm to self or others is imminent, where they have the ideation, the plan, the means, and the timing for that harm to self or others. So I'll give you an example of a situation that I actually took as a crisis counselor. The message came in and she said, "My ex-boyfriend just beat me up." And I said, "Okay, are you in a safe place now?" She said, "No, he's here." And I said, "Can you get into the bathroom and lock the door?" We went back and forth, and I said to her, "The fastest way for us to get 911 there is for you to call 911. And she said, "If he hears me, he will kick down the door and kill me." And I said, "Okay, we can call 911 for you." And so there was, right, ideation, plan, means, timing. He was there. It was imminent. And so I talked to a supervisor. Actually, one of our supervisors lives in Chicago and is here, Becca Ross, over there. Wave, Becca. There's Becca. Yay, Chicago. Yeah, okay. And so a supervisor who are paid full-time staff with a master's degree in a relevant field and lots of experience like Becca, she calls 911. But I'm still texting with the texter while 911 has alerted the police and they are on the way. And I say, "Stay with me. Is there a friend or family member you can get to come there and intervene?" And again, while she's texting me, she can start texting friends and family members. She doesn't have to hang up, because with text, you can text multiple people at a time. 10 minutes later, she says, "The police are here." I say, "Terrific." She says, "I think I need to go to the ER. And I say, "I will stay with you. Can you get that family member or friend to meet you at the hospital?" Here's the thing. That was probably the worst day of her life. And we are complete strangers. I will never meet her. I will never know her real name. She will never know my real name. But I was there for her in her darkest moments, all by text. We do more than 10 active rescues a day. One of the really exciting things about Crisis Text Line is the data. We're essentially a tech company. We happen to be a not-for-profit, but we're a tech company. We use AI and natural language processes all day long on all of these messages. So now I'm about to get a little bit smart. Stay with me, okay? We use the data and the technology in two ways, to make us better and to make the world better. So to make the world better, we plot all of these conversations, we aggregate and anonymize them, and make the data available to the public. So I can tell you the worst time of day for substance abuse. Does anyone want to take a guess? Like, by far. 6 a.m., by far, is when we get the most text messages about substance abuse. You want to guess the worst day of the week for eating disorders? Sunday. Thank you, students. Sunday. I can tell you that Montana is a very beautiful place to visit and has the number one suicidal ideation in the United States. I can also tell you that when mass shootings happen, those states jump up into the top 5 for suicidal ideation. So all of this aggregated data can help researchers and journalists and policymakers and funders to think in different ways. It can also help families and people who run schools to think about how they allocate resources and time, because we now have the data to tell real stories. We also use this data to make us better, like I said. So here's one example. When you go to a hospital emergency room, they stack rank you based on severity, right? The gunshot wound is taken before the kid with a sprained ankle. Hotlines should work the same way. Frankly, I think all customer service should work this way, like Delta Airlines, if my flight is in an hour, please take me before the family that's already planning for Easter, but that's a different story. But certainly hotlines should work this way. So when we build Crisis Text Line, we put a couple of dozen words into an algorithm. Words like die, suicide, overdose. And if those words came in the first couple messages, we made those texters number one in the queue, and we coded the conversation orange so that Becca, as a supervisor, is on high alert watching that conversation while the crisis counselor is also handling it. And that made our response times really fast for severe cases. But this summer, we applied machine learning to the algorithm. Okay, so here's machine learning 101. This summer, we had already processed a total of 20 million messages. It's a lot. What it means is that data corpus has the volume, velocity, and variety to be really juicy. What machine learning does is it applied that algorithm to that 20 million messages, because now we could see what actually ends up, what words actually end up in us having to call 911. And it turns out there are thousands of n-grams, bigrams, and trigrams, so words and word combinations, that are even more indicative of imminent risk than the word suicide. So for example, the word now added to die, suicide, or overdose changes it completely. I want to die is very different from I want to die now, okay? But there is one family of words that is 16 times more powerful than even the word suicide. Can you guess what that is? Take a guess. What is the most indicative? If this word comes in, there's a high likelihood it's going to end up in us calling 911. Take a guess. What's the most common drug in your house? Aspirin, ibuprofen, Advil, Tylenol. Because now you don't just have the idea or a plan, you have the means and the timing. It's right there in your medicine cabinet. So what I want to leave you with is this: what I'm doing, what Crisis Text Line does, is data and science applied to mental health. I probably could be working for Google and helping them make a pretty algorithm to get you Chinese food at 2 o'clock in the morning on the South Side, or I could help you get an Uber in the rain more quickly, but I'd be bored off my ass. I am so happy that what I get to do all day with my team is use all of this fancy data and technology and science to save lives. Thank you.